Well, last week I got out of Romans chapter 1 and made it all the way up to 3, 4, and 5, and even dipped into chapter 5 a little bit. But I want to let this settle in a little bit and bring us back to chapter 4. We're going to pick up in Romans chapter 4 today. Last week was covering a theme that covered several chapters, and so I kind of jumped around with that a little bit, including the ta-da moment. Ta-da! Anybody remember that? Ta-da! Right? Which is, I think, it's for yes, right? Does that mean yes or thank you? Thank you? Thank you. Ta-da! Thank you. Thank you very much. All right. So we learned something last week. Romans chapter 4. Romans chapter 4 says, What then shall we say that Abraham our father has found according to the flesh? For Abraham, if Abraham was justified by works, he has something to boast about, but not before God. Romans has been talking about, as it picked up in chapter 1, I don't want to just keep repeating the same sermon, but this is the same theme and message throughout. It started again in chapter 1 with the notion of God's righteousness. And God's righteousness, that theme will continue to be picked up throughout as we go, so if I come to it again and again, don't be surprised. The righteousness of God is what makes us good enough for heaven. We ain't none of us good enough by ourselves, but because of the righteousness of God, we can be. And yes, I said ain't, so sorry from the South. But the righteousness of God that He provides makes us good enough. We talked about the idea of self-righteousness and how that doesn't make us good enough for heaven. We talked about the unrighteousness of man, where we used to say, forget it, I'm not good enough, I'm not going to even try. So then we talked about the righteousness of God apart from the law last week, which is a new kind of righteousness, a righteousness of God that I can't get by being good enough, but I can get because Jesus was good enough. And that's the righteousness of God by faith in Jesus Christ, meaning if I get on the bus with Jesus, then I'm going to heaven. And you remember some of the running across the platform we did a little bit last week about that. So we're getting on the bus with the Lord. So in chapter 4, he picks up and talks about how Abraham was righteous apart from works. Now, Abraham is the father of many nations, and most specifically, the Jewish nation is the one we think of first. Abraham begat Isaac, Isaac begat Jacob, and on through the Jewish genealogy, through Jacob, who became Israel. But he was also the father of the Arabs as well, through Ishmael. And many other nations come from his loins. But only through the child of promise, through the Jews, was the earth blessed through, ultimately, his descendant, the Lord Jesus Christ, who came and became salvation for us. But in chapter 4, whenever Paul's talking about Abraham, our father, what he's talking about is the top Jew. Number one Jew, the first Jewish person, the first person to be blessed and recognized as a nation set apart, or a person set apart, a lineage set apart to carry the gospel to the nation. So Abraham is revered even today by Jews, Christians, as Muslims alike, all descending from that same personage. So whenever he says Abraham, everybody pays attention. So he says, what can we say then that Abraham, our father, has found according to the flesh? For if Abraham was justified by works, he has something to boast about, but not before God. Now, if Abraham was good because of the good works he did, he'd be able to brag. The problem is, he was not justified because of his good works that he did, but rather because of the faith he has in Jesus. Anything else would be self-righteous. I want to look at Luke chapter 10 and verses 25 through 29. Jesus was speaking to the crowds of people, and he had just sent the 70 to go and to minister into different cities, and they had come and returned and given their reports to him. And he's speaking to them, and in verse 25 he says, and behold, a certain lawyer stood up and tested him. Ever been tested by a lawyer? Anyway. And behold, a certain lawyer stood up and tested him, saying, teacher, what shall I do to inherit eternal life? Now just imagine that was you. Imagine it was you, and someone tested you and said, teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life? And you start thinking, oh, man, what was that? What's that plan? Is there one of those church cards around here? Is the ABCs of salvation somewhere handy? What is it that I need to do to tell one, to answer that question, what do I need to inherit eternal life? Well, keeping in mind that Jesus was speaking to a Jewish audience, those who believed in the law of Moses, those who had been raised on the law of Moses, believing that that was the will of God, and it was, not fully understanding yet that can't none of us be that good anyway, and that only Jesus could. And so he answers this lawyer of the Jewish law, someone trained in the Jewish law, and he says to them in verse 26, what is written in the law? What is your reading of it? What do you think? What do you think would make you good enough to go to heaven? And so he answered and said, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, all your strength, and with all your might, and love your neighbor as yourself. And Jesus felt the same way. Whenever he was asked, which is the greatest commandments? He said, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. And the second is like unto it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. So this Jewish theologian, this lawyer, was on the right track and even said some of the same words that Jesus himself would have said. So when it comes to the law, when it comes to how to be good enough, how to be righteous with God, he had all the right words. He had the right plan. You ever have the right plan, but the inability to be able to bring it to pass? I had the right plan of being able to flip houses and make lots and lots of money by investing a little bit in them and selling them. I could have made millions doing that. The problem is I never could get my first 20,000. You know what I'm saying? If I just had a little bit of money, you know, if I could just get a little bit of money, I could just make my way to New Orleans doing Hurricane Katrina cleanup. And I could make tons and tons of money. I had the right plan, but FEMA had another idea as to how to distribute the work. And so ultimately I came home broke and in debt. You see, sometimes we have the right plan, but we don't have the means to be able to fulfill it. And this is what was happening. He says, Jesus, what do I have to do to inherit eternal life? Because I've studied, I believe I know the right path, and here's my culmination of all the Old Testament laws. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. Love your neighbor as yourself. What do you think of that one, Jesus? And he's like, right on, man. That's the plan. Now, how you doing with that? And the answer of how you doing with it was probably less than perfect. In verse 28, he said to him, you have answered rightly. Do this and you will live. Now, Jesus lets it kind of hang there. Just kind of lets it linger there for a moment. And I'm sure that the lawyer, if there was a silent moment, to just kind of let it hang there in the air, would just kind of feel a little uncomfortable and kind of shift in the shoes just a little bit and say, I think I'm doing that. What do you think, Jesus? Well, the answer, he answered it himself because he says in verse 29, but he, the lawyer, wanting to justify himself, said to Jesus, and who is my neighbor exactly? What is the definition of is anyway? Can you define just a little bit more exactly what you mean by love the Lord or love my neighbor? Exactly who is my neighbor? It certainly isn't those people down the street, is it? Hopefully it's my next door neighbor because we're okay, but not the one on the other side. But what exactly is my neighbor? And the Lord goes on to explain the story of the Good Samaritan, the one who took care of the one who was beaten up and thrown on the side of the road, the one who is least among us, who cared for the other, the one who actually cares for others, the one that was doing the will of God. But as I'm looking at this, I'm intrigued by the answer that the scriptures give in verse 29. The lawyer says, but he wanting to justify himself. He wanted to justify himself because the word justify, if you remember from last week, basically means just as if I had never sinned. Jesus has the power to justify us and make us just as if I had never sinned. But here's a lawyer who says he was trying to justify himself. You cannot justify yourself if you are the criminal. You cannot make yourself better if you're the problem. You cannot pick yourself up by the bootstraps. And this is what Jesus was trying to illustrate to him. You're doing good. You're following the law. Right on, man. Keep going. And this little haunting part of the inside of this man's heart believes, wow, maybe I'm not doing so great as I thought I was. And he begins to realize maybe there's more to this than I thought. Instead of justifying ourselves, we need to let him justify us. when he was justifying himself, he was redefining what righteousness is. When we justify our own actions, when we say, well, you just got to understand, or, well, that's just the way I am. When those kind of words come out of our mouths, then we begin to justify wrong actions within ourselves. We begin to justify ourselves. And when we justify ourselves, we redefine what righteousness is. Righteousness is what God is. Righteousness is always doing the right thing all the time, every time. But when we do the wrong thing, when we do the right thing most of the time, but we fail sometimes, and then we begin to cover that up and say, it's okay because, or it's okay because, or I was just doing so-and-so. I was just doing 75 and a 55. I was just going to slow down as soon as I got to the curb. I was just looking at her, honey. I didn't touch. We begin to justify our own selves, and then we redefine what righteousness is. Jesus said, if you look at a woman to lust after her, you've already committed adultery with her in your heart. But when we say terms like, oh, it's okay, as long as he doesn't touch, guys look, but they just say, as long as they don't touch, we are adjusting what righteousness is, and we redefine what righteousness is, and when we do so, we fail. And we justify ourselves, and in some vain attempt to say, well, I'm doing better than I was, and God's like, no, my righteousness is higher than that. And so we find that ultimately all of us fail. Trying to justify ourselves, we find that we all fail, and as we fail, we go back to admitting that I need help. I need help. I need Jesus to help me. So going back to Romans chapter 4, what shall we say then that Abraham our father is found according to the flesh? If Abraham was justified by works, he has something to brag about, but not before God. Why? Because even the lawyers, even the ones who study the law the best, even the ones who are called Abraham, the father of many nations, even the ones to whom the gospel was entrusted or the law was entrusted, even the very best among us cannot keep the law, so we are stuck with either justifying ourselves or looking to the one who can justify us, who is Jesus. And so Romans chapter 4 and verse 3 says, but what does the scripture say? Well, that's a good idea. Let's start there. Let's stop justifying ourselves. Let's stop redefining righteousness and look back to the source of our faith, the scriptures in verse 3. What does the scripture say? Paul says, Abraham believed God and it was accounted to him for righteousness. So instead of redefining righteousness as me trying to be good enough, no, I didn't fall off. For those that were looking. Instead of trying to redefine righteousness by us being good enough, we need to define righteousness as believing God. That's what the scripture says. What does the scripture say? Abraham believed God, and it, the belief in God, was accounted to him for righteousness. So suddenly, as we're studying this book of Romans and we're trying to figure out how do we attain the righteousness of God, unrighteousness isn't working, self-righteousness isn't working, trying to redefine righteousness isn't working, then what makes righteousness for me? Believing God. That's what Abraham did. He may have been the first Jew. He may have been the first one who was able to be given the child of promise, the idea that through his seed the Messiah would come, the scriptures and the prophets would go through his loins. But it was this thing about Abraham was not that he was the keeper of the law, but rather that he believed God. And that is what ties us to Abraham ourselves. Now, let me look at this a little farther. Verse 3, what does Scripture say? Abraham believed God, it was accounted to him for righteousness. Verse 4, now to him who works, the wages are not counted as grace, but as debt. If you get a job and you work for your wages, then it's just that. It's wages, what you earn. On Friday, when you come to pick up your check, you're usually not saying, oh, thank you. Thank you so much for this money. Wow, I can't believe it's so much. And you only took that much out in taxes? That is so wonderful. Thank you so much. No, you say you earned it. The employer should be thanking you because you did your job and you did your job well and you earned your wages because you had a hand in it. You see in verse 5 it says verse 4, now to him who works the wages are not counted as grace but as debt. Now I'm going to stop there before I go to verse 5. I want to go back to Luke chapter 10 again and we're going to look at verses 38 through 42. Luke 10, 38 through 42. It says, "Now as it happened, as they went, they entered into a certain village, and a certain woman named Martha welcomed him into her house. And she had a sister called Mary, who also sat at Jesus' feet and heard his word. But Martha was distracted with much serving, and she approached him and said, 'Lord, you do not care that my sister has left me to serve alone. Therefore, tell her to help me.' And Jesus answered and said to her, 'Martha, Martha, you are worried and troubled about many things, but one thing is needed, and Mary has chosen that good part which shall not be taken away from her.'" This is a rich passage and a great insight into how we're supposed to approach the Lord. Now, this may be a story that you've heard before, maybe not, but it's that Mary-Martha concept. Martha was the servant. I always think of biscuits, like Martha, there's something of Martha White. Yeah, biscuit mix, yeah. I always think of Martha, because Martha makes biscuits. Martha's the one working in the kitchen. Martha's the one having to clean up after herself. Martha is the servant. She is serving. Don't we talk about service? Shouldn't we serve the Lord? Absolutely. But this is Martha. She's the servant. And then there's the little sister Mary. And Mary doesn't get up and help Martha. She doesn't help make no biscuits. She don't clean up no mess. Oh, no, no. She's sitting in there with Jesus, sitting on the floor, watching and just listening, like everything he says is so important. Meanwhile, the work's being done in the kitchen. I'm a Martha. Now, I shouldn't be. I'm trying to be a Mary. But I'm the one who wants to serve and do, and it is the human tendency to always try to justify or feel good about ourselves or right because of what we do. It's what men always ask each other. "Hey, man, how you doing?" Just a few words into a conversation. "So what do you do? What do you do for a job?" "Well, I'm a snorkeler for Roto-Rooter, you know." Ew! Or, "I'm a lawyer." "Oh, I'm a doctor." "Oh, wow." See, we tend to judge each other by our jobs. We tend to judge each other by what we do. And yet the Lord is more about who we are on the inside. And this is what we find Martha finding her value in what she did for Jesus. And you see here, and just looking at this a little bit closer, in verse 39 it says, "And she had a sister named Mary who also sat at Jesus' feet and heard his word. But Martha was distracted." Martha was distracted with much serving. What was Martha distracted from? The mission. The mission wasn't biscuits. Now, biscuits are good, but biscuits wasn't the mission. Hearing the word of God and being transformed, that was the mission. And if that wasn't the mission, she wouldn't know because she was too busy cooking. Now, do we need to be cooking? Yeah. Do we need to be serving? Yes. Do people need to get out and get the business of the work of God done? Yes. Are there lazy people among us? Certainly so, say all the Marthas about the Marys. But all the Marys are like, "Don't bother me now, I'm worshiping Jesus." And you're like, oh, you're so spiritual. Is Mary more spiritual than Martha because she's sitting at the feet of Jesus? No. No. Is Martha more spiritual because she's doing all the work? No. Neither one is more spiritual. It's Jesus that makes us spiritual. But who's going to get that message? Martha or Mary? Only Mary, because she's sitting at his feet listening. You see, Mary in verse 39 or verse 40, Martha was distracted with much serving. And she approached him and said, "Lord, you do not care. Lord, you do not care." How did she come to that amazing conclusion? She came to that amazing conclusion because starting out wrong, she finished wrong. Starting with false religion, she ended up with a false message and doctrine. Starting with a doctrine that says I can be justified or made righteous by doing good works, then the only natural conclusion of doctrine is that the Lord, God Almighty, who created heaven and earth, didn't care. You don't care that my sister has left me to serve alone. Therefore, and here it comes, you start with being distracted from the true mission because you're not sitting with Jesus. You then therefore reach the wrong conclusion because of your distraction and lack of time sitting with Jesus. And then you create false religion and you say, and then she says, tell her to help me. Therefore, tell her to help me. So I wasn't sitting with Jesus. I wasn't getting the right message. I was distracted. And then I believed something that is not true, and that is that Jesus doesn't care about me. And therefore, I'm going to fix this by telling Jesus what he needs to do to help me with my new religion of service. Therefore, tell her to help me. Jesus answered and said to her, Martha, Martha, you are worried and troubled about many things. Which religion do you want? I don't want the troubled about many things religion. But it is inevitable when you try to create for yourself a situation where you please God by your actions, by your service, you are doomed to be troubled about many things because you will never be good enough if you are justifying yourself by the things that you do. It'll never be enough. Now, that won't stop some of you from trying. Some of you will exhaust yourself, striving ever harder, being more and more faithful, being more and more Martha than you've ever been, making more and more biscuits, cleaning up, staying up longer, doing more, always exhausted, looking for that smile of approval from the Lord, always wondering, is this going to be enough to make me good enough? I stopped cussing, is that good enough? I started giving, is that good enough? I started tithing, now you want offerings on top of that? I'm doing everything I can, Lord. I volunteered to clean the church. What more do you want from me? Everything is the answer. What he wants is our hearts. He did all the work. So then it goes on to say, you are troubled about many things, but one thing is needed. And Mary has chosen, speaking of priority, has chosen that good part which shall not be taken away from her. She chose the good part. There's good parts to stuff. You know that? You know, if you live in a first world society, there's lots of stuff that we don't really need, but then there's some really good stuff that we really want. If you're not living on beans and rice and you actually have a good meal, you can go to the buffet line and ignore all the veggies at the Chinese buffet and go straight for the General Tso's chicken. Yeah, buddy. Come on now. You can hold out for the good stuff. Why? Why? Because you are so stinking rich that you afford to live in a country that gives you so much money that you can be picky about your food. Should we all feel guilty about that? I was kind of, you had to think about it, didn't you? Which religion do you want? Do you want the Martha religion or the Mary religion? If you're Martha, you're like, hey, you better finish that plate. There's starving kids in this world. You should appreciate that. And you know what? Appreciation is good. If your mama tells you to clean your plate, clean your plate. You can all be like this whenever you get older, right? But we are rich in this country because we have inherited it from our forefathers. Thank you, God, for the blessing of living in this country. But way greater than this citizenship is our citizenship in heaven. And as children of the King, we can pick and choose if we want to. Well, but Martha said we should be thankful. Duh. So be thankful. But be blessed, so blessed, that you can choose the good part. That's what it says. Jesus said, but one thing is needed, and Mary has chosen the good part, which shall not be taken away from her. What is the good part? The good part is the righteousness of God instead of me trying to make biscuits to please him. The righteousness that comes simply by sitting in his presence, doing nothing, but being where he wants me to be. listening to his voice, making eye contact with him, worshiping and praising him in the service, spending time acknowledging his goodness, taking up your Sunday morning and showing up for church because I'm going to show up to tell God how much I appreciate the fact he has set me on a journey toward heaven and eternal life. It's the idea that says I'm going to go show my appreciation by being able to be picky and only pick the good stuff. Jesus said, the poor you will have with you always. There is time for soup lines and soup kitchens. There is time for backpack giveaways. There is time to go out and give away water bottles. There will never be a lack of people to receive the service that we could do for him. And I want to do a whole lot more of that. But I never want to allow my service to God to be some kind of measuring stick as to how spiritual I am, because I will never, ever measure up. The good news is the only thing I have to do to measure up is hang out with him. Sit on the ground and watch him speak. Look into his eyes and hang out with the Lord a little bit. Read his word, listen to Christian television, go to church, raise my hand, engage in worship and praise. Don't just sing about God, but sing to him. Spend time with him. Choose the good part. Choose the good part. If you got a choice between cleaning toilets and coming over here and praising the Lord, you get over here and praise the Lord. Better yet, praise the Lord while you're cleaning the toilets. We will not be justified by our works. Now, I'll talk more about Christian service another time. But I would rather we hired out everything we did and did no service whatsoever compared to the good part of spending time in his presence. Because we will not be happy without spending time in his presence. In the presence of the Lord is fullness of joy. At his right hand are pleasures forevermore. Let's see. Religion needs help. She said, Lord, tell her to help me. Why? Because religion needs help. Relationship doesn't. Righteousness ministers to Christ. Mary was being righteous. Religion was needing help. Now, the good part, the meat before the veggies, the dessert first, we can afford to because God is rich. He's rich. I can't promise you you're going to be rich. There are some pastors that will. I can't promise you you'll be rich, but I can promise you that when you stick with the rich guy, you don't have to pay. That's my plan. Out. So, do you believe God wants you rich or not? It doesn't matter anymore. It doesn't matter anymore because I hang out with the guy who pays. That used to be April's dad when I was young. Now it's me. The roles are reversed. You hang out with the guy that's got the money, and he is rich. He doesn't need your service. He doesn't need you handing out water bottles. He doesn't need you in the nursery. We need you in the nursery. He doesn't need you in the nursery. He's going to call somebody. He doesn't need you in children's ministry. He doesn't need you vacuuming the floor. He doesn't need you driving a bus. He doesn't need you to do any of that because he's going to find somebody who has a heart to do it, and he will take care of that. What he needs you to do is spend time in his presence. And when we do, we will find ourselves wanting to serve as well. But it'll be for the right motive. Why act poor like someone who needs to work? Let's look at Galatians 3:25 just to underscore this just a little bit. Galatians chapter 3, verse 25 through chapter 4, and verse 11, it says, Paul speaking to the Galatians, same author, different book. He says, but after faith has come, we are no longer under a tutor, for you are all sons of God through faith in Christ Jesus. For as many of you as were baptized into Christ have put on Christ. There is neither Jew nor Greek. There is neither slave nor free. There is neither male nor female. You are all one in Christ Jesus. And if you are Christ, then you are Abraham's seed. Say it with me. Abraham's seed or descendants. And heirs according to the promise. Heirs? Heirs of what? You are blessed in the city. You're blessed in the field. You're blessed when you come and when you go. And if the Lord is on your side, who shall we fear? For who is like the Lord? That blessing of Abraham is what is yours. The same blessing that God told Moses to say over his people, the same one that we say over you. Oh, but I'm not Jewish. Oh, we're going to look at that for a minute here. If you are Christ, then you are Abraham's seed, verse 29. If you are Christ's, you're Jewish. Sorry. Even though you be a Gentile, you are the seed of Abraham by faith. If you are Christ, then you are Abraham's seed and therefore heirs according to the promise. In other words, because I am now a child of Abraham by faith, according to the scriptures, because I believe in Jesus, then I am now therefore the heir of all the blessings that come to Abraham as well. Chapter 4, verse 1 says, now I say that the heir, as long as he is a child, does not differ from a slave, though he is master of all, but is under guardians and stewards until the time appointed by the father. Even so, when we were children in bondage under the elements of the world, but when the fullness of time came, when the fullness of time had come, God sent forth his son, born of a woman, born under the law, to redeem those who were under the law, that we might receive the adoption of sons. He says, whenever the Old Testament was fulfilled, he says, up to that point, you who are believers in the coming Messiah were heirs with God, waiting for him to pay for everything. We talked about that a minute ago. But really no different than the slaves, because I didn't have the debit card in my pocket. It was okay, though, because they got to hang out with the one who was paying the check. But he says, now is a new. It's new. It's better going beyond that. He says, now we're no longer children, but now we are growing up as heirs. Verse 4, when the fullness of the time had come, God sent forth his son, born of a woman, born under the law, to redeem or buy back those who were under the law. Say were. That means we're not anymore. Why? Because he fulfilled the law, that we might receive the adoption as sons. Verse 6, and because you are sons, God has sent forth the Spirit of his Son into your hearts, crying, Abba, Father. So now, unlike a servant in the master's household saying, hey, just put this on the tab there, you know. I go down to the church and I buy things for the building here and I use the church card and say, ah, just put it on the card there, you know. Why? Because it's not mine to pay for. It's the authority that's been granted to me, but it's not my money. It's the church's money. And in the same manner, so God has an inheritance that he has in store for all who, if we go to the Father, Abba Father, then we can say, put it on his charge. He's got all the money. Crying, Abba Father, verse 7, therefore you are no longer a slave, but a son. And if a son, then an heir of God through Christ. But then indeed, when you did not know God, you served those by which nature are not gods. But now after you have known God, or rather are known by God, how is it that you turn again to the weak and beggarly elements of bondage? What do you mean by that? In fact, you kind of lost me there about three sentences ago. What are you off talking about? What he's saying, let's read verse 10. You observe days and months and seasons and years. I am afraid for you, lest I have labored in vain. He says, when you first came to church here, you signed up for the free salvation. And somebody caught you in the lobby and got you signed up for good works ever since. When did that happen? He says, you started out accepting the fact you couldn't save yourself and took the free religion. You took the free salvation from God. But somewhere along the way, somebody lied to you and created a new religion for you. And hooked you up with the notion that from now on, you're only saved on the installment plan. Jesus paid the down payment, and this is where you signed in blood for the rest of your life. To struggle and struggle and struggle to be good enough for God. That's the wrong religion. That's the wrong religion. God wants us in a faith relationship that says, if you're not having a good time, something's wrong. Well, that sounds like heresy. Bad times will come. That's right. But there is joy in your heart that you can have despite your circumstances. Jesus said that my yoke is easy and my burden is light. My yoke is easy and my burden is light. If your burden is not easy and light, it's the wrong one. It's not the Lord's. And if you are carrying someone else's burden other than the Lord's, then it's probably, that means you're outside of the will of God. Take my yoke upon you, he says, and learn of me. For I am meek and lowly in heart. You will find rest for your souls. When we struggle to be good enough for God, when we try to quit drinking one more time, when we try to quit cussing one more time, when we try to start giving one more time, when we try to our best to be good enough in our own strength and our own power, and we continue to struggle thinking somehow if I'm just good enough, I will please God, then you are no longer carrying that easy yoke and you are now out of the will of God. Oh, great. Now something else to feel guilty for. I already felt guilty enough. Now there's something new to feel guilty for. No, only one thing. When you put on Jesus, when you sign up with Jesus, you signed up for the whole trip. When you first acknowledge that I can't do anything to be pleasing to God, and I can't do anything to save myself, and you first put your faith in God, He latches onto you, He saves you, He transforms you, He makes you new, and you never have to go back to trying to be good enough again. I'm not sure how I'm supposed to say this, so I'm just praying that the Holy Spirit of God speaks to hearts. There are people here, and I know you're here. I don't know which of you, but I were one, and I try not to be one, that are so caught up in the belief that you have to be good enough to please the Lord, that you are miserable. You don't want the alternative. You don't want to go to hell. You don't want to go start being bad. You know there's bad consequences come from that. But you're not happy. You're not sharing your faith because you don't have any good news. You don't understand what good news is. Okay, I got saved, but my life has been miserable ever since. It is so hard being good. It is so hard being good. Stop being good. I'm not telling you to go be bad. I'm saying stop trying to be good. Is that heresy? No, it's the righteousness of God. Stop trying to be good. And just be a son. Just be a daughter. Just be His. And be okay with that. And then if there's time, if you want to, maybe you can pick up something and do something for the Lord. But I'll guarantee you, He doesn't want your service if you don't understand grace. He doesn't want your service if it's not of faith, if it's not doing it because you love Him instead of trying to please Him. How do I know that? Because the Bible says all of our righteousness are as filthy rags. God don't want filthy rags. God don't want you trying hard enough. God doesn't want that. He wants the best for you. And that is fully surrender. Man, I can hear the yeah buts clicking in your mind right now. I can hear it. Can you check those at the door just for a minute? Just long enough to believe that God loves you just like you are. And nothing will change that. Nothing will diminish that. Nobody in this room is ahead of you on the spiritual good works chart. None of us are better than the other. That's good news for me. Because I know a lot of you are doing a lot more than I am. I just get to be seen up here. I know a lot of you are doing a lot of service beyond me, where no one's giving a praise, no one sees what you do. And I don't want to follow you on Judgment Day. I don't want to follow you at the reward ceremony. I give, like, you know, Jesus, I come up for my reward in heaven, and He's like, here's your crown. and it's like a Burger King crown. You know, it's made out of paper. You know, I was like, oh, that's great, you know? And then, you know, I hope that some of you are following me, because you're going to get a big pile. You're going to get a golden crown. You're going to get some blessing because of your faithful service to God. And then what are you going to do with it? I'm going to take my Burger King crown, and you're going to take your good stuff, and we're all going to lay it at his feet in the biggest worship service you've ever seen in your life. And we're going to worship him and praise him and acknowledge that he is worthy. Stand up your feet. He is worthy. He is worthy of all our praise. He is worthy of our glory. And he is worthy of every bit of praise and glory and honor we can shove his way. Lord, we give you praise and we give you honor and we give you glory, for you are worth all of it. Thank you, Lord. Lord, if you want us to do something for you tomorrow, then put it on our agenda. But, oh God, I pray that you would help us start like Mary, wasting time, picking through the plate, shoving the corn and peas out of the way, looking for the steak of your presence. Because, Lord, you have made us rich by being children of God. And you have purchased us, and you have redeemed us or bought us back when we blew all of our money on stupid, selfish things and had nothing left to give you but a broken life. You said, that is not a problem. That is not a problem. Come here, I love you. Heavenly Father, would you draw people to you today, both the saved and the lost that need you, both the ones who have over-experienced salvation and those who have never called on your name to save them before. Would you call all people to yourself today? Would you put your loving arms around all of us and give us that big hug that we have been striving so much to get? Lord, would you heal hearts today who are weary and tired of struggling to be good enough for you? Friend, if you're here today and you have never experienced that Jesus before, you've never asked him to come into your life and save you from your sins so that you can go to heaven and get stuff you don't deserve when you die, like the rest of us, then I invite you to ask him to come into your life right now. How do I do that? By simply whispering a prayer, Jesus, save me. I'm going to lead you in a little more complicated prayer, but it's really not very complicated at all. It's really just you talking to God and meaning it in your heart. So if you want to pray along with me, we can all pray this prayer together of salvation. Dear God, I'm sorry for the wrong things that I've done. I'm sorry I sold out. Gave all of my life and all of my goodness to sin and pleasing myself. But I thank you for Jesus, my hero and my champion, who did everything right and yet suffered in my place on a cross. Thank you for paying for my sins. I can't afford you. I don't deserve you, but I accept you. Thank you for offering yourself to me. I receive your gift of eternal life. Thankful like Mary, or Martha, but sitting at your feet like Mary. In Jesus' name I ask. And thank you, Lord. Amen. If you just did that today, welcome to the kingdom of God. I don't know who you are, but I believe this is God's message for today. It's been kind of a weird day. You know, hurricane weekends are like that. It's just weird stuff going on. You know, people are kind of excited. The wind's blowing, but, you know, it's kind of depressing, and it's cold and windy and dark, and it's just weird. You know what I mean? And I wasn't sure exactly what I was going to do with this message today, but I was just going to preach it and see what the Lord wanted. But I believe the Lord spoke to hearts today. And I believe God wants to set some of you free from being good enough. Just spend a week doing nothing but being at His feet. And then we'll talk about doing something for the Lord next week. Because we love Him. Amen? May the Lord bless you and keep you with the blessing of Abraham. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May He make His face to shine upon you. May He lift up His countenance upon you and give you peace. For you are blessing the city. You're blessing the field. You're blessing the rain. You're blessing the hurricane. You're blessed when you come and when you go. And if the Lord is on your side, who shall you fear? For who is like the Lord? Who's like the Lord? One more time. Who's like the Lord? Go in His peace today and His righteousness.
Amen. Amen.